Hi, welcome back. I have not been posting for a while. The reason why is because of the coronavirus apocalypse and the fact that I've been having to convert all of my live lectures into online format. So I've been pretty damn busy doing that. I've been posting those lectures on another channel called Eric Dodson Lectures. At any rate, I'm back, and this time it's personal. At any rate, in this video, I'd like to talk about burnout. What it is, what its causes are, and what we can do about it. To an extent, I'll be looking at burnout from the point of view of my personal experience in the academic world, which is where I've been working for the last 25 years or so. But I suspect that the insights I've gleaned there would also be applicable to many other vocational domains, and even to things like burnout in our love relationships, or our hobbies, or even burning out on the sensation of being in a coronavirus quarantine, which is where most of us are right now. Anyhow, here's the usual roadmap and the material in this video, and as usual you can find the same roadmap in the description section of this video, along with links to the timestamps. Yeah, so let's start by characterizing what we mean by burnout. Webster's defines the term as exhaustion of physical or emotional strength or motivation, usually as a result of prolonged stress or frustration. And I'd say that that's not a bad start. But beyond that, I'd say that burnout has to do with a pervasive and enduring loss of the sense of vitality, vigor, excitement, and passion in our work. It's not just a matter of having a few difficult days every now and then, or even a difficult month or year, all of which is pretty inevitable in life. Instead, burnout has to do with an abiding sense that pretty much all of our days and all of our years have somehow become colorless and mechanical, as if they've been shorn of their natural vibrancy and zest. So then the question naturally becomes, how does that happen? Well, I suspect that there are three primary and interrelated causes. The first has to do with burnout through simple exhaustion. Basically, trying to do too much with too little for too long. The second happens when our energies and attention are somehow drawn away from doing what we truly love. And the third has to do with burnout through repetition and boredom. But probably a lot of burnout involves some combination of those factors. So let's begin by looking at burnout through exhaustion. Basically, when life is demanding more of us than we really have to give. Of course, it's probably inevitable that we're going to experience that sort of thing every now and then in our lives. But that's not the problem. The problem crops up when exhaustion becomes an unsustainable, enduring pattern in our lives rather than just a temporary thing. At this point, it's probably important to say that that can happen even when we're thoroughly in love with what we're doing. That's because it's entirely possible to become exhausted with something just because of the sheer excessiveness of it over time, irrespective of whether we like what we're doing or not. After all, at the end of the day, we're all just finite human beings who have very limited time and energy, even for the things we truly love. And if we ignore that reality long enough, we'll eventually find ourselves on the road to exhaustion and then collapse. However, one of the tricky things about exhaustion is that it's easy to be unaware of it when it's happening. And here I'd say that the problem of burnout through exhaustion is first and foremost a problem of self-awareness. That's because if we don't have enough self-awareness to perceive when we're becoming exhausted, then we probably won't be able to do anything about it before real burnout sets in and our lives start to become unmanageable. That sort of self-awareness would include several things. First, a realistic perception of our actual capacities, but also an ability to appraise whether the demands of our lives are exceeding them. Of course, developing that kind of self-understanding is not necessarily an easy thing, mostly because it has to do with deepening our consciousness itself. So then the question is, how can we go about doing that? Well, I suppose that the answer to that varies somewhat from person to person. For me, practicing meditation has been an invaluable thing in that regard. That's mostly because meditation has to do with first letting go of all the many deflections and distractions that inevitably fill our consciousness, and then allowing ourselves to be fully and mindfully present to what is, to what we're actually experiencing in our lives. So I would definitely recommend meditation as a vehicle for developing the kind of self-awareness that would allow us to perceive how the world is exhausting us in various ways and causing us to feel burnout as a consequence. Okay, so let's say that we find ourselves exhausted with what we're doing, and we're also more or less aware of it. Well, what then? Well, here I'd say that there are basically two ways of dealing with that. The first has to do with learning what is sometimes a very difficult lesson in adult life, namely, how to say no when we're being asked to exhaust ourselves somehow. It's a little bit strange, isn't it, that one of the first words we learn in this world turns out to be one of life's most advanced vocabulary lessons. That's because saying no at the right time and in the right way means first knowing what our limits and our desires are, and then developing enough backbone to disappoint other people when it's necessary to do so. And all of that isn't always an easy thing. Partly because it involves developing a kind of courage within ourselves, the courage to risk disappointing and possibly angering other people in order to be true to ourselves. And probably for most of us, that takes a lot of practice and many imperfect attempts before we finally become reasonably good at it. But in the long run, I would say that it's completely necessary if we want to avoid the trap of burnout through depletion and exhaustion. And I'd add that learning that skill becomes even more important as we age and our capacities begin to dwindle. After all, without developing the ability to lay claim to healthy boundaries, we're bound to end up in a state of collapse sooner or later. But beyond developing the capacity to say no when necessary, I'd say that there's also wisdom in recognizing when exhaustion is telling us that what we really need is a completely new pattern for our lives, a fundamentally different array of engagements, demands, and rewards, because the exhausting road we're currently traveling is, well, it's killing us. But of course, recognizing when life is telling us that we need to change our path also requires cultivating a degree of self-awareness, as well as a capacity for appraising our lives honestly and forthrightly. So I'd say that at the core of burnout through exhaustion is the issue of self-awareness, as well as the issue of developing the kind of courage that would allow us to change our lives when necessary. Okay, so if simple exhaustion is one possible source of burnout, then how about the experience of feeling like we're being dragged away from what we truly want in life, away from the things we truly love? Speaking personally, I'd say that that's a pretty common phenomenon in the academic world where I work. The reason is that most of us are drawn to academic careers because what we're really in love with is some combination of thinking and teaching. But the problem is that for quite some time, the bureaucratic side of that world has been growing and expanding. Let me give you a personal example to illustrate that. Around a dozen years ago, the powers that be decided that it would be a great idea for all of us professors to undergo yearly mandatory training in a wide range of topics that included, among other things, how to handle dangerous chemicals. You know, like 55-gallon drums of carbon tetra-chloride. And yeah, that certainly would be essential knowledge for chemistry professors, except, of course, for the fact that they probably already know all about it. But yearly training in how to handle 55-gallon drums of carbon tetrachloride was deemed necessary for all professors across campus, including myself. And as I was filling my time and my mind with all sorts of minutiae about how to handle dangerous chemicals, I found myself wondering, my God, how did the Academy ever survive through so many historical periods without this essential training? How did Aristotle and Aquinas and Newton and Einstein and legions of other great thinkers ever manage to contribute anything worthwhile to the world without knowing how to handle 55-gallon drums of carbon tetrachloride? And at some point in the midst of my ruminations, I began to feel a little like Usarian in Catch-22. I began to sense how each inane, picayune, monumentally inconsequential task that draws our attention somewhere else leaves us feeling a little more depleted and a little bit more disenchanted, disconnected, and alienated. And eventually, it's easy to feel like we've somehow lost our souls along the way, like we've compromised the better part of ourselves, our better and brighter destinies. You know, the exact thing that drew us toward our particular careers in the first place. And as a consequence, what had once filled our hearts with real excitement and real zest has somehow become something dull and obligatory, basically just something to get through rather than something to savor and celebrate. And in a world like ours, a world where it can become a daily struggle to preserve some measure of sanctuary from all of that, it's pretty easy to understand how so many of us can feel like we're being dragged away from what we truly love, with burnout as a logical consequence. Okay, so what can we do about that sort of burnout? Well, here my prescription would involve trying to find some sort of fruitful balance between dancing and paying the piper, as it were, between safeguarding what we love so that it doesn't become completely compromised, and meeting life's obligatory demands. But to attain that sort of balance, we need to come to grips with the question of how much of each of those we'd personally find acceptable. In other words, how much of what we love do we really want in our lives, and how much of something else are we willing to endure? And that's definitely a very personal question. In my own life, I've reached the point where I want to be doing what I love, or at least something pretty close to it, at least 3/4 of the time. But hey, that's just me, and I'm not necessarily a reasonable person. As in all things, your own results may vary. However, like I said earlier, we can also lose our love for what we do through sheer repetition, which can easily fill us with a pervasive sense of boredom. And the fact of the matter is that most careers involve a fair amount of repetition. For instance, in the academic world, most of us has to teach the same course over many years, and so there's always the danger that at some point it'll become somewhat dreary and burdensome. I suspect that part of that tendency has to do with something that the philosopher Soren Kierkegaard noticed many years ago, namely, that all of our pleasures eventually lose their charm when we repeat them often enough. And so, when we start to sense that that sort of thing is happening in our lives, it's easy to begin searching frantically for new ways to spice up what we're doing. And while that strategy can obviously allay the sensation of burnout for a while, it's not actually a complete solution to the problem. That's because it's entirely possible for us to become repetitively saturated with the whole game of endlessly trying to spice up things. At that point, it's not just that we're bored with what we're doing, rather, we're meta-bored with our entire lives. In other words, boredom itself has become boring, along with our attempts to find a way out of it. Maybe ennui would actually be a better word to describe that. Anyhow, I suspect that that's where simple boredom begins to turn into real burnout. At that point, it's not enough just to spice up what we're already doing because the problem has become something way deeper than that. And although it's certainly unpleasant, maybe having that sort of experience is perfectly okay at certain points in our lives. Sure, the way we typically talk about burnout can make it seem like it's an irredeemably undesirable thing, perhaps something akin to depression. But like depression, sometimes that sort of experience can be nothing more than life's way of trying to tell us that we need to find some new pattern for our lives, mostly because what's really happening is that we've run to the logical conclusion of our current modus vivendi and we're no longer getting much out of it. As the old adage goes, sometimes what looks like a crisis is actually an opportunity. And so why should experiencing the crisis of burnout be an exception to that? Maybe at certain points in our lives, the fierce wisdom of burning out is exactly what we need most. And at those points, burnout isn't actually our enemy, but a friend disguised as our enemy. But beyond all of that, it seems to me that the element of repetition and boredom in burnout offers us another, somewhat deeper kind of challenge. And here I should probably acknowledge a debt to some insights I've gleaned from my personal practice in meditation, which, among other things, has to do with learning a very different relation to experiences that seem repetitive. In essence, what meditation has taught me is that underneath the surface, it's actually my own resistance to inhabiting the present moment that makes things seem repetitive and boring in the first place. In reality, every moment, and even every breath we take, is something singular, something with its own distinct character and its own unique value. Basically, meditation has taught me that every moment of our lives is like an ever-shifting constellation of stars moving through the larger firmament of things. So, from that perspective, there's really nothing forcing us to become bored with what we're doing, even if we're doing it for the thousandth time. But beyond that, from the point of view of meditation, experiencing boredom is actually a very positive sign. That's partly because when we're thoroughly bored, when the world is failing to stimulate and excite us, that's exactly when we're really thrown back upon ourselves. Because when we're bored, what's really happening is that we're actually boring ourselves. That's because when you think about it, it's never actually the world's fault that we're bored. Because all the world is ever doing is just being the world, quite irrespective of our reaction to it. We're the ones who are doing the boring, so to speak. And the fact is that we could always choose a different attitude toward whatever life is showing us. And so I'd say that in the final analysis, the crisis of burnout, and especially the kind that's produced by repetition and boredom, is really about learning to recognize and honor that reality, and then to assume responsibility for the quality of our lives as we're experiencing them. It doesn't have to be about perpetually trying to spice up whatever we're doing, because ultimately, burnout is a crisis of the soul, an unsettling upheaval in our relation to life itself. And as often happens when we experience difficult times in our lives, sometimes the worst thing we can possibly do is to try to run from it. At this point, it might be helpful to remember that what we run from actually ends up running our lives. And so I'd say that when we experience burnout through repetition, the way out is actually the way in. Consequently, the way to move beyond it is to learn to accept reality as it is, as opposed to how we'd like it to be. It's about learning to appreciate and honor what is without feeling dissatisfied with it somehow. In other words, what it takes to move beyond burnout through repetition is a revolution in our perception of reality itself, as well as in our fundamental values. As I mentioned earlier, I've personally found meditation to be invaluable in that regard. However, I sense that there are many other possible paths that lead to the same basic destination. One road probably has to do with creative and artistic experience. Another probably has to do with prayer and religious life. Still another probably has to do with experiencing our bodies in a particular way, perhaps via dance or yoga or sexuality. I think you get the picture. And so I'd like to move toward ending this video by offering you a prescriptive suggestion that would apply to pretty much any form of burnout, whether it's brought about by exhaustion or how the world is carrying us away from what we love, or through simple repetition and boredom. At one point, the humanistic psychologist Carl Rogers opines that cultivating a helping relation with ourselves is the most difficult task I know. I'm quoting him there. And perhaps at the end of the day, that's also the most encompassing prescription I have for dealing with burnout. To develop a helping relation with ourselves, and hence to allow ourselves to drop the self-defeating habit of refusing to acknowledge our burnout when it's happening, and then to face it honestly and forthrightly, and to take in whatever wisdom it's offering us, even if it means that we have to become courageous enough to change our lives along the way. That might mean learning to deal with our present situation in a new way, or it might mean that our present situation has become fundamentally unsustainable and that we need to find a new and more life-affirming pattern for our lives. But in any case, I'd say that in one way or another, the more fundamental issue has to do with what Carl Rogers is describing, forming a helping relationship with ourselves, because only that will allow us to deal with burnout in any genuinely healthy way, no matter what life is asking of us or where it's asking us to go. Okay, well, thanks as always for watching and for listening. As always, take care of your soul, and good luck dealing with the corona apocalypse. Take care.